The Abraham story that we have just heard is agreeably one of the most troubling texts of all scriptures, both old and new. In the Jewish tradition, it is known as the binding of Isaac. Having received the boy Isaac as his long-hoped-for son and heir, Abraham now receives instructions to make a whole burnt offering of him on the mountain that God will point out to him. God is asking Abraham to take the one he loves and slaughter him as a holocaust. We can ask ourselves, is this the kind of God we have that demands obedience in such a harsh and cruel way? Is this really the way God is? Who wants this kind of God? Why should God ask such a thing of a man to whom he has promised he will be a blessing to the nations? The struggle to find meaning in this story, neither the Jewish community nor the Christian one abandon the story. It's not dropped. It remains. Our version today, by the way, is a shortened one. But the story will come back to us at the Easter Vigil, of all places, in its full length, with all its poignancy. But that it appears today, and again at the Easter Vigil, already speaks to us of how to find its meaning. The rabbis in Jesus' time had already worked with this story. And in their view, Isaac is a willing victim for death. He joins his father Abraham in obeying God's request. Isaac becomes a hero, a martyr. And so today in the Jewish community, the story is a metaphor for all their suffering and persecution down the centuries. They've placed their hopes in God's hands, despite the seeming absence of God during their times of trial, during the Holocaust the community has endured. And we hear the echoes today of the same theme in a line from St. Paul when he says, "He who did not spare his own son, but handed him over for us all. If he did that, how would he not also give us everything else along with him?" Paul understands the Father to have let Jesus enter into the human world of death. He did not hold him back from this human experience. And the Father does this out of love for us. His Son joins us in death, and then the Father stretches out his hand and raises his own Son out of death into life. Jesus is obedient to the Father's desire to love us back to life. And the Father, in turn, is obedient to his Son by being faithful to him. I like to think that the Liturgy of the Word today gives us two icons. The one is the binding of Isaac, and the other is the transfiguration of Jesus. Rich icons that have a story behind them. We can feel them. They are two powerful images, and our eyes cannot help but pass back and forth from one to the other. They seem so different, so opposite from one another. But they do share something in common. Both stories are about a father and a son. And both stories are about the love that passes between father and son. The poignancy of Abraham's story is that he is being asked to let go of his only son for one whom he loves. And then in the story, twice he's called your beloved son. And on the mountain where Jesus stands, he hears a voice that identifies him as this is my beloved son. Now you listen to him. Two fathers, two sons, and both sons are headed for death, and both fathers will not spare them from death, from being robbed of the gift of life. You might think that the second icon of Jesus' transfiguration is all about glory and divinity. But the story, if we look at the edge of the icon, is surrounded by Jesus' impending death. Because just before they went up the mountain, Jesus told his disciples that he had to go to Jerusalem to suffer, be betrayed, and be killed. He says that if they are truly his disciples, then they too must take up a cross. And we heard today that on coming down from the mountain, Jesus tells Peter, James, and John not to speak of this vision with its brightness and glory until after he has been raised from death, and they scratch their heads. Death comes up again on the way down from the mountain. There's no understanding the brightness and the glory or the sun without the death. And Moses and Elijah are conversing with Jesus about what? The weather? The latest football score? No, about the journey that Jesus has to make to Jerusalem. This journey he will complete and fulfill what the Torah and the prophets are all about. He will seal the covenant promised in the Torah and the prophets in his own blood. What is behind the obedience of Abraham? Why does Abraham say yes to what is asked of him? Abraham surrenders the most precious thing God has given him, his only son whom he loves. This son is his hope. This son is his future, and yet he is willing, in the face of what looks like an extreme absurdity, to hand this back to the one who gave it to him. Abraham is willing to engage in trust in the God who makes promises. When what looks like life and future is taken from him, all he has is the word of God. The promise of God, who speaks this word of promise, I will give you an heir on my terms. In Jesus, God has his son bound up by our inhumanity, by betrayal, by violence, by condemnation to death. That's our binding. In his son, God is sharing in our binding. And then the son, what can he do? But he trusts himself into the hands of the Father. He lets the Father's will work. Those are his words. I don't want this, but your will. And his will, the Father's will, does work in the midst of what? Our sin, our death, our bindings. And it raises Jesus up. As Paul says, raises him up to his right hand. God keeps his word. And I think that is the heart of the mystery of Christ we celebrate today. The mystery of Christ on Mount Tabor. The mystery the Father invites us into today by saying, listen to him. Abraham's story of obedience might and should shock us. Because obedience reaches to the heart of self. Real obedience asks for self-surrender. And Jesus' obedience to the Father needs to shock us as well. He remained faithful to the Father, walking into the power of death. All he had was the words, "You are my beloved son." That's all he carried. And what about all the bindings in our lives? The bindings that have caused us anguish and questions over the last decade up to now. What about the 20th century Holocaust? What about nuclear destruction? What about racism that never seems to let go? Or mistrust in institutions we treasure? Or most recently, gun violence. These are all bindings, our bindings. We struggle with all these, never mind the deeply personal bindings that each of us knows as well. And there seems to be sometimes no answer, no sound, no voice that comes. We could lose faith. Or, like Abraham and Jesus, we can climb the mountain of Moriah and Calvary, carrying the wood of our cross. We can join Jesus in trusting the Father to the end. Then, when we have done that with the only thing we can carry, faith, hope, and love, then we will know that the surrender of ourselves opens up to the glory of the mountain of the Transfiguration.